weeks and we'll be done. Well, about 10 more weeks. But we're getting through. So tonight, I really believe, is an important message. One that we need to hear again. I think we need to continue to hear at least several times a year. Remember where we came from. You know, Peter talks about that at one time we were not of the faith. We were not of this community, but we were of the world. And now we're no longer of the world, but we are of the faith in Jesus Christ and the blessings that come with that, but also the responsibilities as believers and how we ought to act. So this is a reminder tonight for us as we look at chapter 38 in Genesis about the depravity of man. The depravity of man. It's such a sorry story. Let's pray and we'll get into it. Father, we do come before you. And we pray that you would open up our ears, our hearts, our minds to you, Father. Please, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, illuminate your word to us, Lord. Help us. Give us understanding, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would even help us to see our own sins, Lord. Where are we at this moment? And where are we headed, Lord? Father, I pray that the Holy Spirit would take these words of yours and would just make them alive so that we can see it truly with open eyes. No veils from the enemy or from self, Lord. But Lord, that we'd be open to hear the voice of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Genesis chapter 38. It is a familiar story. We've probably heard it before many times. I know I have heard many messages on it. And so I'm excited about the fact that God reminds me personally of the misery of sin, which is tonight's theme, the misery of sin. It was Dehan, who is one of the writers on the Daily Bread, who wrote this: "Is God aloof from human pain that ravages the mortal frame?" He says, "Oh no, Christ felt our agony when sin and death he overcame." Isn't that beautiful? You know, God is not a stranger to the pain that we suffer. He totally understands and knows our very heart. It's what makes him God and all-knowing. He understands how it affects our very frame, our body, our mind, our very soul. In fact, he felt the same agony that we feel from time to time. But he overcame that sin through his own death on the cross. He truly did. And he has given us victory that we can walk in if we choose to. And that is the part of sanctification, where God allows us the opportunity to be co-workers with him in our relationship with him, where we have an input, where we can make decisions, where we can choose to do right or choose to be wrong. That's a part of sanctification. And so this evening we're going to look at basically three things that, as a reminder to us, what is sin? And I'm going to expound on these things so that we really, really grasp the depravity of it. What is the consequence of sin? And how do we get victory over sin? So what is sin? What are the consequences of sin? And how do we have victory over sin? Let me give you the context here. You know, it's interesting that chapter 38 is the only insight that we have about what's going on in the home of Jacob outside of Egypt. You remember last time we met, the brothers got together and they put Joseph in a pit and then sold him, and he went off to Egypt. Now many years have passed by, and all of a sudden God puts within chapter 37 and 39, chapter 38. And 38 happens to deal with what's going on at the home of Jacob, and specifically with Judah. And with Judah, because Judah is in the line of Christ. Jesus will come from the lineage of Judah and Tamar. And so he wants to give us a picture of the lineage or the genealogy of Jesus Christ here. In 22 years of history, this is all that we really know what happened in Jacob's homeland. From the time of Joseph sold into slavery until Jacob came down into Egypt because of the famine to find victory and deliverance from that situation. And it seems that Judah here, although chosen by God for the line of the Messiah, was not chosen for the birthright. And it could be because of chapter 38. And that's sad because he missed out on so much. So let's look at this chapter and we're going to look at those 3 points. So Judah begets some children while he's in the land of Canaan. So soon after Joseph had been sold into slavery, it says in verse 1, it came to pass at some time, it doesn't tell us exactly what time, that Judah departed from his 10 brothers, for Joseph was sold into slavery and visited a certain Adullamite whose name was Harach. An Adullamite was not a Jew, nor was he of the land that God had promised to the Jews. He was an outsider. He was from another nation. And Judah creates a relationship with this individual. And Judah saw there in that land daughters of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua. And he married her. Now, when he knew that he should not have married her, he went ahead and did it anyway. And he went into her, and that's the Bible's way of saying that they had consummated the marriage. And so she conceived and bore a son, and he called his name Er, and boy, did he err. And she conceived again and bore a son and called his name Onan, and she conceived yet again and bore a son and called his name Shelah. He was at Chizbid when she bore him. So Judah begins this association with this man outside of the family of faith, a man named Harah. What does God have to say about that? And I'm just going to real quickly say, be warned that you don't create relationships outside of the family of God. Wait a minute, are you saying we can't associate with the world? That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying you have to beware that when you do that, you may all of a sudden be a part of the world. And that's something that you need to understand and know, that there's a tendency to be drawn back to that world. Now, if you're ministering to the world and your goal is to reach your friends because you love them, you don't want to see them going to hell, then yes, by all means, associate with them, hang out with them, and take the opportunities to preach the gospel to them because you love them. But if you are just associating with them like Judah was doing here, it is a big mistake to have friends outside of Christianity. Continuing his linkage to this outside person, which didn't have a believing faith in God, Judah then marries an outside person, a Canaanite woman. And Jacob's boys at this point are getting older, so now he's looking for wives for them because that was the custom. And where is he looking? Not within the community of faith, but he's looking outside of the faith. They couldn't go to Laban. Laban was too far. They had already messed up that relationship with his ancestors. And so he goes here to this community. And so in verse 6, it says, Judah took a wife for Er, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. And you've probably heard that name before, Tamar. And she is in the lineage of Jesus Christ. But Er, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord killed him. We don't know what it was that Er did. It doesn't say. It just says that he was wicked. And then the Lord killed him. So that tells us that it was enough wickedness that was deserving of death. It was that bad. But we have no idea, and for me to even guess is only that, just guessing. But it was enough to warrant death. I think sometimes God actually is merciful when he takes us like that. He spares us from so much. and possibly so much destruction that can go from there forward. There comes a time when the Lord will put such a person out of his misery, in a sense, because his whole life is miserable. And there's no reason for him to go on because of the wickedness that he is doing. And really, that is what sin does. It literally destroys. So my first point is, what is sin? What is sin? The dictionary says, an immoral act considered to be a transgression against divine law. Now, you can take that right across the board to any religion, right? It is a immoral act in whatever religion you're in against that divine law. That is what is considered sin. We live in a culture where the concept of sin has become entangled with legalistic arguments over right and wrong. Now, understand this as I go through this. I'm going to really try to get you to understand the depravity of sin, because it's not what you really think it is. I mean, we do get into those arguments. Well, what's right and what's wrong? And we think it's just as simple as that, of what's right and what's wrong. And we argue and debate over it, the Ten Commandments, the Golden Rule. I live by the Golden Rule, and those types of things. But sin, I think, goes deeper than that. When many of us consider what sin is, we think of the violation, right, of the Ten Commandments. You know, you didn't love God. You stole. You covet your neighbor's goods. You committed adultery. And we think of sin that way. Now, even then, we tend to think of murder, adultery, as major sins, and sins compared to lying and cursing and idolatry. It's not as big of a deal because they're not big sins like murder or adultery. And so a little lying is okay because it doesn't hurt anybody, at least we think. And then I like what Romaine used to always say, a little lying is like being a little pregnant. Right? You're pregnant. Doesn't matter if it's a little or it's not. And if you lie a little, you're still a liar. And that's the truth. We might feel that we live by the Golden Rule, and that's fine, you know. Hurt nobody and you should be okay, right? Do as you please and you're fine. Don't worry about anything. You know, who are they to tell you what is sin or what you can do and what you can't do? But the truth is that sin, as defined in the original translation of the Bible, means missing the mark. That's what it means, to miss the mark. And missing the mark can be in a negative sense, but it also can be in the positive sense. If God asks you to do something and you don't do it, the Bible says that's sin. You missed the mark. Because God asked you to do this and you didn't do it. You missed the mark of God. And so it's not always negative. Don't do that, because then you're sinning. But if God tells you to do something as simple as this, getting a packet together for the homeless, and he lays it on your heart, and then you go like, oh, I'll do it later. And you're there in the store, no, I don't, it's not the time. And you just continue to put it off and put it off, and then it's too late. Well, I think that if God has been telling you to do it, and you don't do it, that's missing the mark also. The mark, in this case, is the standard of perfection established by God and evidenced by Jesus. Perfection. Perfection. Being perfect. Loving God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, not having anything between you and Him. Never lying, never stealing, never cheating. Perfection. That's really what God requires. And we see it in Jesus, right? He was perfect. Corinthians tells us He had no sin in Him at all. Perfect. Now, view in light of that light, it's very clear that what? We're all sinners. That we have missed the mark, right? It's clear that none of us are perfect and that we are all sinners. So the Apostle Paul says in Romans 23, chapter 3, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And when he says all, he means all, everybody. all sinners. Now, he's not saying it in the sense where we use it sometimes to justify our sin by saying, well, you're a sinner too. That's not how he's saying it. He's saying it that you are the sinner and you shouldn't be looking at someone else's sin because you sin too. That's what he's saying there. He's not saying, oh, go ahead and sin because he's a sinner too. And so he's just as bad, so it justifies you being a sinner too, so enjoy it. It's not what he's saying. He's saying that you shouldn't be looking at anyone else because you're just as guilty as they are. We all have sin. The synonym for sin is immoral. We've all been immoral. We've all wronged or wrong done. We've acted evil, done wicked things, transgressed, committed crimes, offenses, misdeeds, misdemeanors. We've all done those things. Here is the biblical list of sins. Galatians 5:19, talking about the works of the flesh. Very clear. Adultery. Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 says that adultery starts in the heart. You begin to lust for it. Fornication. Having relationships before you're married is called fornication. Uncleanliness. Lewdness. Those two go along with adultery and fornication. They're sexual. They deal with, I guess the best way to describe it is spring break, and you have all these kids going to the beach being lewd and unclean. May not be having fornication, sexual relationships, but they're lewd and they're sexual and sensual. Idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies. That's false teaching. Envy, murder, drunkenness, rivalries, that is fighting, arguing, and the like. I mean, there's more that Paul probably could have went on to describe. And he says, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also have told you in times past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. What is the result of sin here? Death. You will not inherit the kingdom of God if you practice these things. If you're in the habit of doing these things constantly and regularly, then you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. That means what? I'm not saved? Yes, that's what it's saying. That means when you stand before God, he won't let you in. You will be judged. That should scare some people. Now, in light of this, it does no good to compare ourselves to others then, because we're all guilty. We all have our own sins. We cannot escape our failures of being to be righteous in our own strength, because we can't. And this is by God's design. God has specifically designed it that way. There is no way that we can be righteous or perfect. We have to understand our weaknesses. We need to rely on the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ. That doesn't mean that you go on to sin, but you understand the importance of Jesus' death on the cross and the work of Jesus Christ because of your sin. Sin is mentioned hundreds of times in the Bible, starting with the original sin in the Old Testament with Adam and Eve that ate of the tree. And that was a simple obedience of don't eat of that fruit. But they ate of it and missed the mark. And of course, that brought in sin to the whole world. And sin is simply the violation of any of God's laws, including the Ten Commandments. I mean, if God has commanded us something in the New Testament, as James says, be doers of the word, not just hearers, and there are a lot of hearers that hear the word, but they don't do the word. And we need to get back to doing the word of God. Paul, however, puts it this way in his perspective in Romans 3:20. When he says, therefore, no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we became conscious of sin. And so Paul was saying, you can try all you want to be perfect, but you ain't going to do it. You can't do it. God has designed it that way. The law was designed to show you that you were a sinner. and that you will never be perfect. We have to understand that and really grasp it and believe it, that that's how depraved we are. And so we really need Jesus on our side. We need the blood of Christ to flow on us. We're dependent on him completely. And God wants us to recognize that. He wants us to recognize sin, but he also wants us to recognize our dependency upon him. Now, even though there are some who have not murdered, committed adultery, they'll find themselves being convicted of lying or whispering false lies or worshiping little idols like wealth, power, beauty. These are all little things. And so, yeah, I'm not guilty of committing murder, but are you guilty of somewhere else? Have you fallen short and missed the mark? Sin has its beginning with Lucifer. We know that. The shining star, probably the most beautiful and powerful angel known in heaven. Not content with his position, he desired to be higher than God, and that was his downfall from the very beginning of his sin, was to be like God, to sit on God's throne and rule his own kingdom. When he was renamed to Satan, he brought sin to the human race in the Garden of Eden, and that's where he tempted Adam and Eve with some enticement. And what was that enticement? Genesis chapter 3. If you eat of this fruit, will you not be like God? The same thing that he was enticed with. Will you not be like God? In other words, you will be God, and you can rule over your own life. You don't need him to tell you what to do. You don't need him in your life at all. Just enjoy your life and forget everything else. And so they bought that lie, and they bit the apple, and sin entered into the world. So since that time, sin has been passed down through all generations of mankind. And we, Adam's descendants, have inherited sin from him. It's an inheritance from him. And by the way, before you think, well, if I was there, I probably wouldn't have done that. No, you would have done it. Because we're all sinners and fall short. Romans 5:12 tells us that through Adam, sin entered the world. And so death was passed on to all men because the wages of sin is death. You see, the point of sin is to let you know you're no good. You can't do it. You can't be perfect. There is no way at all. In fact, there's no one that's good. Only Jesus. He is good. That's just the taste of the depravity of sin. The next point is going to be the consequences of that sin. And we'll see that as we see the consequences here. Judah, look at verse 8. And Judah said to Onan, go into your brother's wife and marry her and raise her up as an inheritance to your brother. But Onan knew that their heir would not be his. And it came to pass when he went into his brother's wife that he emitted on the ground, lest he should give an heir to his brother. And the thing which he did displeased the Lord. Therefore, he killed him. So Judah's first son dies because of this wickedness. So there was a custom. It's called the kinsman redeemer, the goel. And it is a custom that we find in Deuteronomy chapter 25. And it talks about keeping the inheritance within the family groups. And the way that they did that was that if a woman marries the son and then the son dies for whatever reason, then the next son would marry her, have a child, and then that child would take a place of her first husband and the name would go on. Then the rest of the children will continue on with the second brother. And that was asked of this brother by his father to fulfill this. And he decided that instead of impregnating her, that he would just waste the seed and throw it on the ground. And that's exactly what he did. And so he was disobedient to his father. He was disobedient to God and to that commandment. And so God killed him also. Notice in verse 10, the thing which he did displeased the Lord. Therefore, he killed him. He killed him because he sinned. He missed the mark of God to reproduce an heir for his first brother. Then Judah said to Tamar, this daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house till my son Shelah is grown. For he said, lest he also die like his brother. And Tamar went and dwelt in his father's house. So the command was, you killed my first son, and now my second son, and now my only son who's very young. It's going to be a while before he marries you. He's still not of age. So why don't you just go wait at daddy's house, and then when he's of age, I'll send him over there. But the intent was never to send him over there because he feared that he too would die. She's kind of like a black widow, to them right now, and just killing off their sons. And so he's protecting his son at this moment. What's interesting is she does it. Look in verse 12. Now, in the process of time, the daughter of Judah's wife died, and Judah was comforted and went up to his sheep shears at Timnah, he and his friend, Hera the Adumelite. And so he's still hanging around this guy. His wife dies in time. He's saving his son. He gets comforted finally. The time of mourning and the period has gone by. Let's go and shred all the sheep's skin and then prepare for this whole celebration as we do this. And it was a party time, really, basically. Because, you do that. When you go out to work, you work hard. And then when work's done, you get out there and you have yourself a nice drink and you kind of party after that. And that's exactly what he was doing here now that he felt comforted because of his wife passing away. In verse 13, we see Tamar re-entering the scene. And it was told Tamar, saying, look, your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep. So she took off her widow's garment. So she was literally at her father's house waiting. She was at least obedient to her father-in-law. Covered herself with a veil, wrapped herself, and sat in an open place which was on the way to Timnah, for she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. Then Judah saw her. He thought she was a harlot or a prostitute, because she had covered her face. Then he turned to her by the way and said, please, let me come in to you, for he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. So she said, what will you give me that you may come in to me? So she now has an opportunity here. So she realizes, okay, here's Judah. His son's of age. What's going on? I'm going to find out what's going on. I'm going to put on this harlot outfit. I'm going to go out there in the streets. I'm going to pretend to be a harlot, and then hopefully I'll be able to find out what's going on. Here comes Judah and says, wow, obviously you're a harlot. You're dressed like a harlot, so how much you want? What do you need? I'll give it to you. And she's like, well, what do you want to give me? And so she takes advantage of it, and she sees an opportunity to trap him. And verse 17 says, he said, I will send a young goat from the flock. And she said, will you give me a pledge till you send it? So give me something so I know that you're going to send it later on. Then he said, what pledge shall I give you? And so she said, your signet and cord and your staff that is in your hand. I mean, that's pretty significant. That's some big evidence. She's thinking ahead here. Very cunning. Very cunning. Then he gave them to her and went into her, and she got pregnant. She conceived. So she arose and went away and laid aside her veil and put on the garment of her widowhood. And Judah sent the young goat by the hand of his friend, the Adumelite, to receive his pledge from the woman's hand. But he did not find her because she wasn't a prostitute. Didn't find her at the temples. Didn't find her at the places that prostitutes hung out. And so he came back home. And he asked the men of the place, saying, where is the harlot who was openly by the roadside? And they said, there was no harlot in this place. So he returned to Judah and said, I cannot find her. Also the men of the place said, there is no harlot in this place. And Judah said, let her take them for herself, lest we be shamed. Okay. Kind of a shame there how he thinks that way. For I sent this young goat and you have not found her. In other words, leave her alone. We don't want to, start making some ruckus. People start talking. Why is Judah looking for this harlot? You know, and forget it. Maybe people will forget it. Maybe people won't notice, you know, and I won't be shamed from it all. And so Tamar becomes pregnant. Look at verse 24. And it came to pass about 3 months after that Judah was told, saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, she played the harlot. Furthermore, she is with child by harlotry. So Judah said, bring her out and let her be burned. Wow. Reminds me of another story, right? King David, when Nathan talked about a landowner stealing a little lamb from another landowner, and David was like, where is that man? We'll get him and we'll kill him, man. And Nathan looked at him and said, you are that man, for you took Bathsheba, another man's wife. And David lost a lot from that, didn't he? Verse 25 says, when she was brought out, she sent to her father-in-law, saying, by the man to whom these belong, I am with child, she said. Please determine whose these are, the signet and the cord and the staff. So Judah acknowledged them and said, she has been more righteous than I, because I did not give her to Shelah, my son, and he never knew her again. Wow. At least he acknowledged it. Like, whoa, I'm caught. Those are mine. I'm guilty. You're more righteous than I am. I should have given you my son, and I should have trusted in the Lord, but I didn't. The consequences of sin. Obviously, the ultimate consequence, and I think we all know this, and it's a severe consequence, and that's death. Not just physical death, but also spiritual death. And that's ultimately the consequence of sin. Now, we've already determined that we're all sinners. We've broken God's law, and there's no way at all that we can be perfect. There's just no way. So really, our destination in that state is death. When we stand before God, we'll be separated from God. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. And this not only refers to that physical, but that eternal separation from God into hell, where God will say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you because you've practiced those things. Even though you felt like you did righteous things, again, I've kept some laws, but you broke so many others, you're still guilty. And so he says, you are a worker of iniquity. Isaiah says it this way in chapter 59, verse 2, but your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. That's separation. When God separates you into hell, you will never hear from him again or see him again. And this is the foremost consequence of man's rebellion against God. Definitely, we understand that. That is the major consequence. And so many hope that God is loving and caring and understanding that he'll just overlook our little faults. You know, they're just kind of little discretions. And he's definitely not going to hold us accountable for those things. I mean, years ago, a young lady who had a ministry to some of the students over here in Rupa Valley, came to the church ministering, and we partook of that ministry, her husband, and several kids. And all of a sudden she came and said, you know, I feel that God wants me to be happy. Doesn't God want us happy? And isn't that what he's about, happy and love? And I've met a young man that I'm in love with, and I want to leave my husband for this young man. No, God doesn't want you that happy. Sorry, that's not how it works. You have made a commitment and a vow forever until death do you both apart and you go to heaven. And we pleaded and reasoned with her, but she felt, but God is so loving. He's so caring. Won't he just overlook these things? No. He can't. He's a judge. And a judge hands down sentences. Now, God is loving, and he is caring, definitely. And that is why he hands down sentences. Can you imagine if judges went around and just kind of said, hey, I'm a loving judge. I guess they do it, right? I don't care. Go ahead. You know, hey, so you drunk drove several times and killed several people. I love you, man. I just love you. Just, you know what? Case dismissed. Go out. Have fun. Because I just love him. No, that judge would say, because I'm a loving judge and I care about the people that are out there trying to make a living that have little kids and you come along destroying their lives. No, you're staying in jail. You're staying in jail. Bail set for $3 million. God is a loving, caring God, and because he cares about truth and righteousness, he cares about other people too, he will not let us get away with sin. He will not do it. If we practice it, we will die. Little white lies, cheating on your tax return, taking a pen when no one's looking at you, secretly viewing pornography. These are peccadilloes. You know what peccadilloes are, right? The very minor or slight sin. They're just little peccadilloes. What's the big deal? Who's going to notice? God notices. God notices. They're not worthy of death? Yes, they are. Because sin is sin, big or small. You're missing the mark. And it's clear in Scripture. Though God loves us, his holiness is such that he cannot live with evil. The prophet Habakkuk described God this way. Your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You cannot tolerate it. And so God will not dwell with it. God does not ignore our sins. On the contrary, as Numbers 32:23 says, you may be sure that your sin will find you out. It's clear. You can't get away with it. Even those secret sins that we hide in the recesses of our hearts will one day be brought to light. God will bring them to light. Hebrews 4:13, nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. And so when we stand before God and he says, oh, this is what you did. When did I do that? I don't remember doing that. Oh, you want to see? Here it is. I was there. You can't get away with it. And this big light shines right on it, and you go, oh, okay, you're talking about that? Oh, I thought you were talking about something else. No, I'm talking about that. But let's talk about something else. Can't get away from it. It will be revealed. Also, sin leaves a stain or a scar. And here's where it gets deep, guys. Yeah, we're separated. And I say yeah in the sense like that's pretty big. But sin, as we live this life, scars. It scars. And with some, it scars very deep. No man is the same. No woman is the same after sinning. Sin will be forgiven. Suffering may go away. But scars remain till you die and become a new creature in Christ Jesus, or sent to hell if you're in your sins. That's what sin does. And you know what? The enemy knows that. He just knows how it destroys and devastates lives. And it's just not that individual. There are a lot of people around that are casualties. Scrap metal that just flies all over the place and just destroys. I mentioned it earlier, but you look at the story of David, sin against Uriah, murder, adultery with Bathsheba, and what God's response was to him. God forgave him. God forgave him. But his family was in shambles. He was running from his children. He lost his kingdom. There was so much destruction in his life. God forgave him, and that's amazing grace. Definitely amazing grace, and we need to depend on that. And God's forgiveness, God forgives the sin and takes away the penalty of death through Jesus Christ, definitely. But as believers walk this earth, and when we give in to sin, it scars us. Not only does it scar us personally, messes us up in the mind, and our emotions and thoughts, but even those around you that know of it and get involved in it. And it's just destruction. And you have to live with that misery for the rest of your life. And it's not an easy thing. Take it from someone who came from the world. I spent 24 years in the world. Well, okay, I can minus my childhood, but I had a very active childhood in destruction. I just grew up on the streets and I did things that were bad. And I still suffer the consequences of those things. They still haunt me from time to time. And believe me, it is not worth it. And though I'm cleansed by the blood of Jesus, thank God, and I'm saved and born again, I still struggle with some of those old sins. And I have to battle and fight against them. And it's not fun. And there are times where it is miserable. It is miserable. I thank God for those of you that did not have that type of life in the beginning, that you were born into the Christianity and you won't experience some of those things, hopefully. Although the sin is taken away and the death sentence removed, yet Nathan said, nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, the child that is born to you shall die. That is sin. Death of a baby child, a parent, is a miserable place to be. Proverbs says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but the end is the way to death. We need to stop thinking for ourselves. We need to let the Lord think for us. So Tamar then gives birth. Look at verse 27, and we'll close. Now it came to pass at that time for giving birth that, behold, twins were in her womb. And so it was when she gave birth that one put out his hand, and the midwife took the scarlet thread and bound it on his hand, saying, this one came out first. Now they did that because of the birthright. So as soon as that hand out, they tied it, he's the firstborn. So he gets all the inheritance and the birthright. Then it happened as he drew back his hand that his brother came out unexpectedly, and she said, how did you break through? This breach be upon you. Therefore, his name was called Perez. After his brother came out, who had the scarlet thread on his hand, and his name was called Zerah. The victory of sin, and I'm going to close with this, the victory over sin. We got to have victory, right? Because it's like, wow, okay, so we're sinners. I am a sinner. I can't measure myself to anyone. Because I have told a little lie, that means I am a liar. I hope we're not continuing to lie. And definitely there's repercussions even as believers. If we sin, we're going to suffer repercussions in this world. But yes, we'll get to go to heaven when we die because God is gracious. We depend on his blood. We trust in his work and not our own work. And so God is going to reward us because of our faith in Jesus Christ, because we're saved by grace through faith in the work of Jesus, and it's not of ourselves. But how do we have victory over sin as believers? This is the struggle, right? I don't know how many messages I've heard in my 30 years that talks about the victory in Jesus, and I'm still waiting for a message that really gives me the nuts and bolts of having victory over our sin. I have not heard one. You're not going to hear one tonight either. I wish I was that man and I could tell you I got total victory, but I don't. But the Bible does speak about victory. In fact, I'm going to share with you what John Monroe, a senior pastor of Calvary Church in Charlotte, said. And he writes about the victory in sin. He gives this wonderful little picture of a cockadoo bird, and how this bird is put within a nest of another bird. That's how the birds lay their young. They lay them in another bird's nest, and they just fly away, and that bird ends up taking care of that bird. That bird is a big bird, so it throws out all of their youngs, and then the mama's just feeding them, and it's growing, and it becomes a bird in itself. And he makes that picture because that sin, it destroys everything around you. You know, it consumes you. It has no concern for others at all. So he gives us that picture. And then he says, when we are saved by grace and start to live a life of grace, we soon discover strong opposition. Sin, like this cockadoo bird, has an insatiable appetite and it takes over everything in your life. How do we get victory over that? First, by living a life of grace. Oh, this is so important, and something that I have learned is that we live a life of grace. Paul said in Romans 6, 1 through 19, he presents three steps of living that life in grace. First, there is something that we need to know in Romans 6, 3 through 9. Though salvation is by grace, and we as believers are united with Christ in his death and resurrection, this union with Christ is a foundational concept of a life of grace. We are to live by grace now. We can't live by the law because we can't fulfill it. And so we live by grace. We walk by grace. And when we stumble and fall, we confess our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive us and wash us, and we continue on. So the Christian walk is one that walks by grace at all times. And we should be gracious towards one another too. Union with Christ means that when Christ died, now this is important. Now I don't know how this works yet, and I'm still working on it. But this is important for us to understand, and it's something that maybe you might want to write down and really study and look at. But when Christ died, it means that we also died with him, spiritually speaking. He died on that cross, we died too to self. When Christ was buried, we were buried with him. When Christ was raised from the dead, we were raised with him. And now we live in a newness of life. Now, I understand this. Because there was a time that I lived in ignorance. I didn't know what was right and wrong, and I just lived by my passions, by my lust. But now I know right and wrong, so I live this newness of life. Oh, don't do that. There's consequences. Stop. Pray and ask God to give you power over that thing. So I understand that. We can do that. We have that authority because of the grace of God now. So being a Christian is not just believing about Christ or trying to imitate him or follow his teachings. It is vital, dynamic, living relationship with the living Christ. Why it's so important to be in his word. Why it's so important to be in fellowship. Why it's so important to serve, because you're living that dynamic, living life like Christ. And this is where the power comes in. The strength comes in to give you the victory over sin. So our faith is not just faith about Christ, but rather faith into Christ. He is our very life. He's our very breath. We believe into him. That is, we are united with Christ. Christ died for me. That's my justification, what he did on the cross for me. But I died to Christ, or with Christ also, which is my sanctification. And that's what I mentioned earlier. In that aspect, everything I need to live a victorious life of grace is found in Christ, in my unity with him as my sanctification. In sanctification, he is setting us apart. Now, how do you get set apart? Well, I can think of, you know, you want to take some rocks. Today, I guess when you find gold, you don't literally find nuggets, but you find gold within rocks. And you want to break those rocks up. You want to melt those rocks down. It goes through the fire, and then the gold begins to emerge. So there's a process of breaking and setting it apart. And God is doing that in our lives. And so he allows us to go through things to set us apart, to purify us, to make us holy. And so we go through trials, and we now have choices. As I go through this trial, do I want to be victorious and learn my lessons, or do I want to give in and to the flesh and try to escape? And I'm hoping that we want to be victorious, learn our lessons, and be co-workers with the Lord towards sanctification. It is the sanctification where we have a part to work in. We have to make decisions and choices. We need to live victoriously and choose to live victoriously because we're united with him. Second, there is something to consider. We consider, which means to reckon or count ourselves as dead to sin. We need to understand that in our mind. We are dead to sin. I don't feel like it. You are dead to sin. This is a part I don't sometimes get, because sin is always there. And it will always be there because the enemy is there. But we need to realize that we are dead to sin as Christ was dead and buried. We're dead to it. We really are. By faith, we're dead to it. We need to believe that. And then when sin it confronts us, we need to tell it, we are dead to you. I don't need to give in to you because we're dead to you. And when you're dead, guess what? You don't feel anything, right? I can come along and kick you and punch you and write all over your face. You're not going to get mad at me. You get mad at me now. If you're alive, I start drawing all over your face. But if you're dead and I do that, you're like, well, I'm not going to respond because I'm dead. And so we're dead to sin. We don't respond to it. That's the dilemma I have. Okay, so where's the power in that point? That's where the Holy Spirit comes in and a good prayer life. Where we're on our knees and our faces before God and we're saying, Lord, you got to give us the victory here. You need to give us the power over that sin that we are committing. And it only comes through that divine relationship that we have with him. Christ's resurrection demonstrates his victory over sin. And now that you are united with Christ in his resurrection, you have the victory over sin. And we need to believe that that is true. But I fall and I stumble. Okay, then get up, confess it, and attack it again. Sometimes it means getting busy so you're not tempted. As one guy put it, if you like jelly donuts, quit walking by the donut shop. Displays the jelly donuts, you know. Take another route. Don't go by there. If you're at home and you have nothing to do and you're just laying around and there's sin, get up, go do something, go work out, get a buddy, pray with them, come to church, help out. We could always use help here. There's a lot of work that needs to get done here. Do something for the Lord. We figure out ways of having victory over the sin. God now has given us the ability to see and attack these things with logic and with his divine power. Third, there is something to present. We are to present, to yield, or to offer our bodies to Jesus Christ. Romans is very clear in chapter 6, verse 13, 16, and 19. First, let me say the negative. Don't go on presenting your members of your bodies to sin. And that's what Paul said. We don't continue to sin. So don't keep saying, oh, where sin is, grace abounds much more. So, hey, let's make God's grace really abound and I'll just continue to sin. No, don't do that. We can't do that. We have to fight against it. So don't go presenting your bodies to sin. As I mentioned earlier, take a different route. In the positive, the members of our bodies are to be presented to God. We are the temple of God now. And so we are now to present our bodies to God as a living sacrifice, which is our reasonable service. And so we present our bodies to the Lord. Lord, this is your body. What do you want to do with it? How do you want to serve? You know, I posted something on Facebook this morning about about a husband loving his wife and honoring her. And I sincerely mean this when I say that Virginia and I have been for 30 years now serving the Lord. And I didn't even realize this till I thought about it this morning. I've been posting marriage things every day on Facebook because of Valentine's being the February. So I just thought, hey, that'd be a good time to post marriage stuff. So I post a little bit of our life and then a scripture and then I'll come up with a little quote. So I've been doing that on Facebook. And today I chose that scripture, and so I talked a little bit about how we have for 30 years been serving the Lord. Started off in a little church, just serving the Lord, cleaning toilets and sweeping stuff. My wife got involved with the nursery and then the children's ministry, and for 30 years, we have not stopped once. We have continued on for over 30. There has never been a break in that 30 years. It went from that church to this church, and we are still doing it to this day. And it seems like I'll be doing it till I die, the way it's going. And that's fine. This is what keeps us going. And within those 30 years, yeah, we've had a lot of struggles, a lot of pain, Christ seems, made a lot of friends. Going to have many friends when I get to heaven. Seeing souls saved. Virginia has wiped baby bottoms probably for those 30 years in that nursery. And if you know Virginia, she's tough. Those kids get the gospel. They know about hell. They know the book of Revelation. And normally our kids come out of there saved. And then they come over here. And then I mess them up. But yeah, 30 years. And it's not going to stop. We need to present ourselves to the Lord. We are the Lord's. We are the Lord's. We're the scalpels. We're the hammers. We're the nails. We're the tools that he uses to impact the lives of others. How do we get victory over sin? I think that's just the beginning, right? I think it really is. And it is a journey, isn't it, of trials and mistakes. I look at it as a journey. I have tried different things. You know, I'll take one approach. Okay, Lord, I'm going to try it this way. Okay. When it happens again, Lord, I'm going to try it this way. All right. So what do you want me to do? Okay. Oh, okay. Let me try it this way. And that's where I'm at. I just keep trying different ways until I finally figure out how to have victory over it. You know, and a lot of stuff he just takes away. Like, I don't smoke anymore. He just took it away. Didn't have a desire for it. Just went away. Alcohol just went away. I was at a party one day, and I'm witnessing. I got a beer in my hand, and God says, "What are you doing?" Like, I'm witnessing. Well, what do you got in your hand? I'm like, oh. Here I'm trying to witness about living a sanctified life and got a beer in my hand getting drunk. So I'm like, threw it away and said, I don't want to do that, Lord. Haven't picked it up since. God just takes things away. But there's other things that I struggled with, and I've shared those things with you. Let me close. From my heart, I've seen for 30 years people, all kinds of people, different faces. I'll tell you, what I've seen that's consistent, sin. Faces change, ages change, but sin is always consistent. I have never seen the change of sin. It's always usually the sin that the Bible talks about that these people, that these brothers and sisters have dealt with. And I've watched them come and go. I've watched some go on to be successful, very few, but many go on to live destructive lives. And miserable lives. And I don't want that for anybody. I didn't want it for them. I don't want it for you tonight. And that's why I shared that message tonight, to remind us that sin does one thing, and it destroys us, and it doesn't stop. You get a divorce, and some of my boys are divorced. It's not over. It's not over even after those kids turn 18, because now you're dealing with all of that garbage, all that influence from the courts. They're no longer your kids. Legally, they're the court's kids. That's the law. They become theirs. And so they now tell you how you're going to raise those kids. And that's the law. And that brings destruction within the family. And that's the battle that the church has with the state. So it's not an easy thing, and I've seen it over and over again. All for the lust of life, for the lust of eyes, and it's not worth it. It's not worth it. Peter's very clear that this life is just a vapor. It's passing. What's important is eternal life. Billions, quadrillions, and whatever other number after that, you can live and do whatever you want for eternity. Just get through this life. Be faithful to the Lord. Love one another. Serve him.